are redeemed.
Amen.
Well, how do you know that Christmas is coming? Was it in early October when Walmart put out the Christmas decorations? Or the glut of commercials for all of us men to be reminded over and over that every kiss begins with K? Or that he went to Jared so that we'll know where we're supposed to go? How do you know Christmas is coming? Well, if you look around, the signs are everywhere and the announcements are made and the message is very, very clear that Christmas is coming. So what do you do to get ready? How do you prepare? You decorate your house and you go shopping and you plan parties and you plan family time and you find your Christmas sweaters that you have to wear. And all you do all of those things to make sure that Christmas looks like it's coming in your little part of the world, because the message is clear, Christmas is coming. Well, how do you know that the Christ is coming? The message, if you stop and listen, is pretty clear. And that's what Advent is for. It's to help us to stop in the midst of all of the commercials and the decorations and the announcements and the specials and everything. It's to make us stop and prepare and get ready and work toward that, so that we don't just rush ahead, so that we don't just plow through all of the preparation that went into the Christ coming the first time. We need to prepare ourselves for that too, so that when it comes, our hearts are ready and our lives are ready to truly accept that gift that God is giving us that we celebrate this time every year. We lit two candles today. Last week was love. Today is peace. Which is and it just hit me as I was sitting up here how appropriate it is today on December 7th that we think of the Advent bringing peace on a day that we remember an act that was anything but, and the beginning of years of conflict that led to us having to work again and again for peace. But today, while we remember that, we also remember and look forward to the coming of a real peace. Now, if you look in some Advent schedules, it also talks about this Sunday as preparation, which is appropriate because true peace doesn't just happen, does it? Real peace is not something that's just going to show up in our lives and just show up in our families, because that peace that we're talking about is more than just an absence of conflict, isn't it? Just because conflict isn't present doesn't mean that we're actually living in peace with one another. Any more than the fact that we may not have any particular sickness at a given time means that we're really healthy. The absence of sickness doesn't mean health necessarily, because we could still be very unhealthy people. The absence of conflict means that we could still be people not living at peace. But the Advent reminds us of the coming of a kingdom of peace, a coming of a kingdom that changes truly everything. I think our readings today speak of that peace and talk to us about the reality that is coming, but also the reality that is already present in our lives. They tell us of a future coming and revelation of God's kingdom, but they also invite us to live in and prepare for that kingdom even now, every day. They challenge us to do what we can to allow that realm, that kingdom, to be known and experienced more broadly in our own lives and in our families and in our community and in our world. So with that in mind, let's turn to some very familiar verses from Isaiah 40, which most of you sang last night and heard if you were at the Messiah. Very familiar verses that we remember this time of year. Isaiah 40 is the beginning of what's known as 2nd Isaiah. It's written many, many years after the first part of the book, and the tone of everything changes. It's at that point the message shifts from one of punishment and judgment to one of comfort and hope. And that's where we pick it up today, at the very beginning of that shift in the prophet's writing. It's as if in our text today, after years of punishment and exile, God looks down at the Israelites and says, "That's enough." Now, this can be difficult when we get into that, because it almost sounds like we're reading about a God who is a cosmic scorekeeper, a dispenser of wrath who looks down and says, "Okay, you've spent sufficient time in the corner to have learned your lesson." And if we just read that one verse or two where God says, okay, that's you've been punished enough, we might get a very messed up view of God that doesn't seem to fit with everything else that we read of God throughout the Scriptures. What I see as I look at the way that God dealt with the Israelites and throughout Scripture is not so much a God who is looking for opportunities to punish us, but a God who allows people to see their choices all the way through. A God who allows people to deal with the consequences of the choices and the behavior in their lives. Because that's what happens to Israel. The prophets tell them over and over, and they make their choices, and the consequences must be endured. And if we see God that way, as one who is going to allow us to see our choices through, then the message in these first few words of Isaiah 40 come crashing in as an incredible note of divine grace as God speaks comfort and promises to once again walk with them and lead them personally to a better way. And the job of the prophet now changes from proclaiming judgment to proclaiming comfort and peace as God says that they've suffered enough for their sins. Suffered not so much because God is looking to punish them for it, but suffered because we know that sin hurts us. And sin hurts us because sin hurts relationships among us and our relationship with God. And God says, that's enough. Let's fix this. At this point, it seems that God has looked and said that I can't take any more of seeing my people suffer. And he declares the divine intent to join them in the journey. But in that intent also comes a challenge and an invitation. Verses 3 and 4 speak of something that is, I think, both a promise of a life to come, but also something that the people of God are to be about in the meantime. The kingdom of God is both something to be looked forward to later on in the future as it is fully revealed and experienced, but also something to be lived in and into every day. The kingdom of God is always something that is already here, but not yet here. And we live in the tension of the kingdom as we know it and the kingdom as we expect it. But we can't just expect without living in now. What Isaiah's words call us to is to recognize what that's going to look like. And we're told that when God's glory is fully revealed, the valleys will be lifted up and the mountains laid low and the rugged, uneven places made level and the crooked paths made straight and the kingdom of God truly changes everything. And that's God's work. But what I also see there is not just something about what is going to happen, because the call is also to prepare the way for this kingdom, to prepare the way for this peace. Not that we are to literally change the landscape, but we are to be about leveling the ground on which we stand, so that some are not forever relegated to the low places while others enjoy the luxury of the heights. The voice calls out for us to prepare the way. And interestingly, that way is to be prepared in the wilderness, in the desert places, away from the expected centers of influence and power. But isn't that exactly what we see playing out in the story of the birth of Jesus? It doesn't happen in a palace. John the Baptist doesn't come and stand in the temple. The story is beginning to play out at the margins, on the edges, and we get a glimpse there of the message that is coming and the reality that we will see, and that is that salvation comes to and from, not centers of influence, but from the margins, from the edges, from the dry places. So what does all of this mean for us? How do we prepare this way? What do we do to prepare the way for the Lord? So that we can get an opportunity to see and know the glory and the grace of God, and so that others through us and among us can see the same thing. Well, I think it requires us to do some pretty tough work in a few areas. If we're looking at this as a leveling of mountains and a raising of valleys, this means that we might have to do some work in our society in terms of economics, where we decide to take seriously that there really is a very quickly widening gap between people who have enough and people who are barely getting by, and people who have way more than they need. There is a gap. And we need to recognize in a world with sufficient resources, that it should never be acceptable for someone to have so little that they can't get by, for a child to go hungry, for a person to go without care. The economy of God is one of generosity and abundance and enough. It's different than the economy of the world where we focus on competition and security. In God's economy, children shouldn't go hungry and nobody should hoard out of fear, but rather we should share out of freedom and confidence. If we're going to prepare the way, we need to wrestle with this and do something about it in our own lives and in the society around us. And it's overwhelming, and we might ask, well, can we change the system? And the reality is no, we probably can't. But we can change the way we live, and thus open the way for others to know this grace as well. That we can do. This work might take place in terms of social standing and access to fair treatment for people in our world. Preparing the way for the coming of God's kingdom might mean that we decide that we're really finally ready to take an honest look at things like racism and sexism and prejudice and the way that people truly aren't treated the same. It might mean that we have to wrestle with and come to agree with the words of Martin Luther King Jr. when he said that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. If we're going to prepare the way, it might mean that we begin to live and treat people as if they matter just because they are, and because they are children of God. And it means that we stop trying to decide who's worthy and who's not measuring up, and rather just work to remove the things that get in the way of people being able to see God. It might mean that we stop listening to the screaming and the bullying voices from both sides of public debates that are held in the media, and instead we listen for the whisper of God, or the hoarse call of a wild-haired prophet who calls us to see things very, very differently. And if we do these things, it might change the way we view events around us. Whether it's protests in another state, or Ebola in West Africa, or questions of marriage and equality, or crime and punishment. If we're going to prepare the way, we have to do our part to level out the uneven ground and smooth over the rough places. And we might even, in that process, have to tear some things down that only stand in the way of seeing the glory of God fully revealed and known. And here's why all of this matters. If you continue reading on in Isaiah after the talk of changing the topography, what we're told is that the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and here's the important part, and all the people shall see it together. To really see the glory of the Lord, to really experience the coming of the kingdom of Christ, we have to be able to see it together, standing side by side, without the hindrances that keep someone out or the obstacles that we build to block another's view. The glory is revealed to be seen together on level ground. That's where peace can be found. Not just in the absence of conflict, but in replacing the conflict with genuine relationship, authentic community, something altogether different. Peace. And I know, as you do, that we can't bring all this about. That's God's work. And it may well be that we can't even bring about any real change that extends much beyond our little part of the world. And that's okay, because the depth of the change and the breadth of the change, that's God's work. But the effort in repairing relationships and in living out this change that is in us, that is our job. That is how we prepare the way, in us and around us. So as we wait for the kingdom to come, and as we wait for the glory of the Lord to be revealed, we don't just go sit in a field and stare up at the sky waiting for something to happen. Instead, we are to set out to tackle the hard work of building bridges and tearing down walls and lifting people out of low spots and helping us all to find a place to stand and worship together. And we do this for a couple of reasons. One, because we're already experiencing at some level, in some degree, that transformation and change and that grace in us. And we know that that needs to flow through us. And we do it because we know that the day is coming when that kingdom will be fully revealed. And and it's our job to prepare for it. If we shift now over to our gospel reading, we're going to pick up John the Baptist again in a few weeks, and I had a lot I wanted to say about him today, but I'm going to let the hair get a little wilder and the beard a little longer before I do that. So we'll pick John the Baptist back up a little later, but what I wanted to pick up on was that very first line that we read from Mark's gospel, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The beginning of the good news. Now, the term good news was one that had been used a lot in that day, but it was used to herald a military victory or the ascension of a new ruler. That was good news. Those were glad tidings. Mark takes that word and turns it over on its head and says, here is the beginning of the story of good news. Something new is about to happen. And for those who know the prophecy of Isaiah and who have been living with this expectation for so very long, comes crashing in this message, here is the good news. Something new is about to happen. After all of these years, the promise is about to come closer to reality. The God who has promised to come is about to come in a most unexpected way, not to the sinner, but to the margins. His coming is announced by what I imagine as a gaunt, strangely dressed, and probably rather wild-looking prophet who stands not in the temple but in the desert. And instead of going to the people of power, he stands out on the edge and people come to him. I almost envisioned it as if in the midst of our decorating and preparing for Christmas and putting up the tree and all of these wonderful things, and we're having a party and everything looks just right, and in the middle of it, all of a sudden wanders this prophet who looks around at it and says, repent. Because someone powerful is coming. In the midst of our preparation, that's what Advent does for us. It makes us stop. And it makes us hear this voice of this prophet who once again tells us we need to repent. We need to reorient our priorities. We have to prepare the way once again. But the other thing I saw in that first line from Mark, and I think it's a wonderful reminder for us at the beginning of the church year, again. It's the beginning of the new story. Just the beginning. We are invited then into the story to be a part of the ongoing telling as we experience transformation in our own lives and as we seek to live out that change in the world around us. It's the beginning of the good news, and the story continues to be told. We're invited to join in the writing of those next chapters of the building of God's kingdom as we work to build community and live lives of mercy and grace and generosity and trust that God will take the gift of our lives and make of it something beautiful for the kingdom. As we move through this Advent journey together this year, realize that once again we are at the beginning of the story of the good news and that there is a part in the unfolding story for each of us and for those around us who need to know that this God came and is coming for them as well. So may we then be about the work of preparing the way, not out of duty, but out of joy, overwhelmed that we get to be a part of this story, that we get to help prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. So that together we can fully see the glory of the Lord revealed. That is the gift